Welcome, everyone, to our online service. We trust you have had a good week, and we are pleased that you have joined with us today to be refueled for the week ahead. Allow the singing and the Word of God to speak to you today, and be blessed.
Welcome to the Good News Baptist Church website. It has been completely redesigned, especially for these trying times while we are not able to physically attend church service. Our aim is to make information more accessible and provide a significantly improved user experience. Our website will feature frequent updates and new messages in addition to our social media and video activities. The website is also optimized for tablets and smartphones, providing more ways for you to follow us. We wanted to enhance your experience of our church services from a distance and hope you enjoy our new website and its features. The design gives a light, fresh, and new feeling. The navigation has been restructured so that it is now easier to directly access specific content on our site. It also provides an easy access to the most frequently retrieved content, like our live streams. All links to the topics in the main navigation, for example, who we are, leads to clearly laid out subpages. The subpages features two main sections that can be reached by clicking on the corresponding tab. The overview section provides entry-level information that's easy to access and helps to get familiar with the topic. More in-depth information can be found once you click on the Read More button. The new design has a feature for those living abroad to donate with our Easy Access Donate Now button. Members can also use it to pay tithes by just clicking on the Donate Now button, then following the simple steps required. Users can also subscribe for our Good News Updates here. There is so much more to discover. Visit the all-new Good News Baptist Church website at gnbcnetwork.org. Designed for a better experience.
Now before you, you will see the church's website. It is a brand new website. And towards the top, to the right, there's a button that says Donate Now. So if you desire to donate, you go ahead and you click that button and a new tab will appear. The new tab would allow you to see what we see in front of us right now. You would see the Good News Baptist Church logo and you would see some information on the right concerning this opportunity to donate. In this box, you're allowed to enter your donation amount. And just as an example, I am going to enter $100. Then right next to it, there's a Donate Now button in blue. You go ahead and you click that. And a different page appears. Now this is actually what is called the cart. So here you would be able to verify your donation amount, which is $100, and the entity to whom you will be donating. If everything appears okay, then you go over here to this blue button that says Proceed to Checkout. You click on that. Then the checkout page appears. So what you would do here, you would fill in your billing details. I'm going to go ahead and pretend that I'm donating. I'll put my first name and my last name. Company name is optional. Here you would select the country or region. All right, there we go. I found St. Martin. Of course, you would choose the country or the region where you live. Here, you would put your address. All right, you put the tone, the state or the county, postal code or a zip code if you have one. If you do not have a postal code or a zip code, you could go ahead and just put 50. If you desire to leave your phone number with us, you could do that. Very important is your email address. So you go ahead and you put your email address in this portion. Because of course, you will receive confirmation of this donation. All right. If you have additional information, special information that you would like to pass on, you could do so in this box. All right. Then towards the right, there's a little opportunity for you to verify once more that the amount that you want to give and the cause you would like to give it to. Our cause is listed as Online Church Services. All right. The only way in this opportunity, the only way to give is using your credit or your debit card. So you go ahead and you click here. If you have a Visa or a MasterCard, then you're free to donate via this means. Go ahead and you click here. Of course, you would need to read this information here. Make sure you understand it. Make sure you're comfortable proceeding. And if you read, understood, and agree with it, then you will go ahead and you click here. Then you'd move on to donate now. All right, here we go. Some verification information as well. Here, now you've received an order number. Of course, the date of you placing that order is here, the total amount, the payment method. All right, here's a little notice thanking you. And here's the opportunity to pay securely using your credit card. You would enter the number here. All right, you would also enter the expiration date and the CVV code. All right, then you would go ahead and click on this button that says pay securely via CXP. Bear in mind, CXP is the medium through which we've been able to set up to receive these donations. All right, so after you reviewed everything, it looks good, enter your card information and expiration date and so forth. You go ahead and click on pay securely via CXP. Of course, I'm not going to click on it because the information I entered was just information for you to see what to do. It is not valid information that I entered here as card number and so forth. But I just wanted to take you through the steps necessary to give your donation. And folks, I want to say thank you very much because donations like this help us to make sure that the Word of God gets out. In this time, we've been forced to go online as a church, and with going online, we've noticed that we are now able to reach many more people than we were able to reach just by having services in our building. And if you contribute to this, let me say thank you very much on behalf of those here at Good News Baptist Church, on behalf of God as well. Thank you very much for contributing to this ministry and to God's work here on this earth.
Blessings, my brethren. I greet you in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who is our soon coming King. What a joy it is to be able to come and to present the Word of God. And I trust today, as the Word of God is presented, that it will be presented in such a manner that each and everyone would understand the truth of the Word of God. I am so thankful that you have joined us, even though we are not able to be in service as we would love to be. I could only imagine seeing you where you usually sit, and in my mind, I can see you there, but I know that you are at home, and I trust that you are receiving the Word of God loud and clear. And not only that you are hearing the Word of God, but you are allowing the Word of God to minister to you and to bring about the necessary changes in and through our lives. Don't just be a hearer of the Word, but be a doer of the word also. When I spoke to you on this subject, Lord, deliver me according to your word, I believe that I still had some other thoughts to share with you. And I will go back to Psalms 119 and read from verse number 69 down to verse number 76 and see what the psalmist David is saying here, and then draw some thoughts from that, let you know what I spoke to you about before, and then draw some thoughts from that and give you part two of this message. So let's go to Psalms 119, and let me begin reading for you from verse number 69. Listen to this man of God. Let my cry come near before thee, O Lord. Wow. As I hear this, I can recognize that this man of God, he's praying. And he's saying, God, let my cry come close to you. Give me understanding, he says, how? According to thy word. In verse 170, he says, let my supplication come before thee. Deliver me according to thy words. My lips shall utter praise when thou hast taught me thy statutes. My tongue shall speak of thy word, for all thy commandments are righteousness. Let thine hand help me, for I have chosen thy precepts. I have longed for thy salvation, O Lord, and thy law is my meditation. Let my soul live, and it shall praise thee, and let thy judgment help me. I have gone astray like a lost sheep. Seek thy servant, for I do not forget thy commandments. What a man in touch with his Lord. Let's pray. Our Father, we listen to the words of our brother, the psalmist David. And Lord, he is asking you to do some things for him according to your word. And Father, I join with him today, and I ask that you would speak to us according to your word. And Lord, as you speak to us, may we allow your word to minister to our hearts. Have mercy upon us. Help us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I am amazed as I go through the book of Psalms and recognize how many times David asks God to do a thing according to his word. Just in Psalms 119, he said several times in verse 28, my soul melted for heaviness. Strengthen thou me according unto thy word. In verse 49, he says, let thy mercies come also unto me, O Lord, even thy salvation, how David? According to thy word. In verse 58, I entreated thy favor with my whole heart. Be merciful unto me according to thy word. In verse 65, thou hast dealt well with thy servant, O Lord, according to thy word. Verse 76, let I pray thee thy merciful kindness be for my comfort, according to thy word, unto thy servant. I am afflicted very much. Quicken me, O Lord, according unto thy word. 116, uphold me according unto thy word, that I may live, and let me not be ashamed of my hope. 154, plead my cause and deliver me. Quicken me according to thy word. 169. Let my cry come near thee before thee. O Lord, give me understanding according to thy word. And then he says it again. and 170. Let my supplication come before thee. Deliver me according to thy word. What a prayer. What a plea by this great man of God. So I speak to you today with a message entitled, Lord, deliver me according to thy word. Now, what is it that we need deliverance from according to the word of God? In my last message that I shared with you from this text, I shared with you that we need deliverance from the guilt, the power, and the penalty of sin. I shared with you that we need deliverance from the power of evil. And then I went ahead and I shared with you that we need deliverance from the temptations too strong to bear. With all of that said, Pastor, is there still some more that we need deliverance from? You better believe it. Here's what we need deliverance from. Let me begin today by saying, we need deliverance from the terror of fear. What do we need? We need deliverance from the terror of fear. Listen to the psalmist. In Psalms 34, verse 4, I sought the Lord, and he heard me, and he delivered me from all my fears. What? He said, I sought the Lord, and he heard me, and he delivered me from all my fears. Today, my friend, there are so many people that are so fearful of all that is happening in the world today. I mean, if you look at the news, I mean, you got a right to be fearful because there are so many negative things happening in the world today. And you begin to wonder, I wonder if it's going to happen to me. With the coronavirus going throughout the world and killing so many people, as you look at the news, you become very fearful and it messes with you. And you begin to wonder if something like this would happen to you. It is said that this is a testimony of one of David's men who was in a cave with David. He said, I saw the Lord, and he answered me and delivered me from all my fears. What? In a cave? He said, I saw the Lord, and the Lord answered me, and he delivered me from all my fears. You see, when fear comes upon you and you are bound by it and you need deliverance from it, what do you do? When it comes and you need deliverance, what do you do? I say what you and I need to do is to bring those fears to the Lord. Bring them to the Lord and ask him to deliver you from all your fears. When we ask him to deliver us from all of our fears, he will deliver us. He tells us that he brought his fears to the Lord, and he was delivered not only from some of his fears, but he was delivered from all of his fears. So my question to you today is, what are you fearful of? Are you fearful of dying? You see, if you know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, you have no need to fear when death comes. When it's time for you to die, you have no need to fear because the very same psalmist said, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. In Proverbs chapter 1 and in verse 33, the Bible says, but whosoever hearkeneth unto me shall dwell safely and shall be quiet from fear of evil. What? He said, if you would only hearken unto me, if you would only pay attention to what I'm saying, if you would only practice the word of God, he says, you shall be quiet from the fear of evil. The fear of evil will be no trouble to you. Paul wrote to Timothy, in 2 Timothy chapter number 1 and verse number 7, he says, for God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. So when you find yourself fearful of anything that may surround you, fearful of anything that is happening to you, you need to stop and tell yourself immediately, this is not from God. For God had not given us a spirit of fear, but what God has given us, he has given us a spirit of power, a spirit of love, and a spirit of a sound mind. And you see, when you are fearful, it messes with your mind. Now, here's what he did for those who were so fearful. In Mark's Gospel, chapter 4, verse 39, the Bible says, "And he arose and he rebuked the wind, and he said unto the sea, Peace be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm." You see, if he can speak to the wind, if he can speak to a hurricane, if he can speak to a storm and say, "Behave yourself, keep quiet, be still," and the storm would obey him, then what about the things that you are fearful of? What about you? He's telling you, "Behave yourself, stop worrying, trust me, and all will be well." What do we need deliverance from? We need deliverance from the terror of fear. And fear is a terrible thing. Don't let it get hold of you. Then, secondly, we need deliverance from depression and loneliness. You see, with all of these job losses, with all of these things that are happening, with all of the sickness going round today, I am sure that there are people who are depressed. And depressed people become very lonely. And don't you think that because you are a child of God, that you can't become depressed or you can't become lonely? Because the scripture tells us of a great man of God who became depressed and very lonely. In the book of 1 Kings, chapter 19, verse 1 to verse number 15, the Bible said, "And Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, and with all how he had slain all the prophets with a sword." Here is the man of God. He had slain all the prophets with a sword. And now Ahab goes to his wife and he tells her all that he did. And then Jezebel sent a messenger unto Elijah, saying, "So let the gods do to me, and more so also, if I make not thy life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time." She has threatened the man of God. After she heard what the man of God did, she threatens now the man of God. The Bible says in verse number 3, "And when he saw that, he arose and he went for his life, and he came to Beersheba, which belonged to Judah, and he left his servant there." Hearing what this woman said that she would do to him, this great man of God that had conquered so many, when he heard what this woman said that she would do to him, notice what he did. He ran. He ran. In verse 4, the Bible says, "But he himself went a day's journey in the wilderness, and he came and he sat down under a juniper tree, and he requested for himself that he might die, and said, It is enough now, O Lord. Take away my life, for I am not better than my fathers." Here is this great man of God. He is so discouraged. He is so depressed that he leaves his servants away off. He goes a little further into the bush. He finds himself under a juniper tree, and he decides, "Here will be a good place for me to die. God, why don't you take away my life?" But as I read this text, isn't it true that Elijah is running from a woman who decided that she's going to kill him? So Elijah, if you really wanted to die, why didn't you stay with where the woman would find you and let her kill you? But you're running away. Now you find yourself so depressed, so down, you're asking God to take you. Yes, that's what depression does. That's what loneliness does. The Bible says in verse number 5, "And as he lay and slept under the juniper tree, behold, then an angel touched him and said unto him, arise and eat. The man is so tired. The man is so exhausted that he lies under this tree. And as he lay there under this tree, oh, the angel of God came, met him asleep, touched him and said to him, arise. In verse number 6, he said, he looked and behold, there was a cake baking upon coals and a cruse of oil at his head. And he did eat and drink and laid himself down again, a cruse of water, at his head. And the angel of the Lord came again in the second time and touched him and said, arise and eat, because the journey is too great for thee. And he arose and he did eat and drink and went in the strength of his meat 40 days and 40 nights unto Horeb, the mount of God. And he came thither unto a cave and he lodged there. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him and said unto him, what doest thou here, Elijah? And he said, I have been very zealous for the Lord God of hosts, for the children of Israel have forsaken thy covenant, thrown down thine altar, and slain thy prophets with the sword. And I alone am left, and they seek my life to take it away. And he said, go forth and stand upon the mount before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and a strong wind rent the mountain, and break the brick in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in an earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in a fire. And after the fire, a still small voice. And it was so, when Elijah heard it, that he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood in the entering of the cave. And behold, there came a voice unto him and said, what doest thou here, Elijah? And he said, I have been very zealous for the Lord God of hosts, because the children of Israel have forsaken thy covenant, thrown down thine altar, and slain thy prophets with the sword. And I alone am left, and they seek my life to take it away. And the Lord said unto him, go return on thy way to the wilderness of Damascus, and when thou comest, anoint Jezreel to be king over Syria. Watch this. Here is a man of God experiencing victory after victory. Just speak the word and it happened. Look at a life of victory. When you get some time, read chapter 17 all the way down to chapter 19 of 1 Kings. He is on the Mount of Carmel as he challenges the power of darkness. He stood up to Ahab. He stood up to Jezebel and to Baal's prophets. All of a sudden, he is tired, exhausted, and fled for his life, according to 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 3 and verse number 4. He felt dejected, fearful, and depressed. He even went as far as to pray to die. He suffered a spiritual relapse. God came to him. And God delivered him. My friend, I say to you today, if you are lonely, if you are depressed, you need deliverance from loneliness. You need deliverance from depression. Because loneliness and depression would cause you to want to die. And God isn't finished with you yet. So you need to get up from where you are and pray to God and ask him to deliver you from depression and from loneliness according to his word. And the psalmist is asking God to deliver them. Is there a promise that one could consider in regards to this? Here is one found in Isaiah chapter 41 and verse number 10. He says, fear thou not, Lord, why is it that you don't want me to fear? Or how shall I stop fearing? He said, fear thou not, for I am with thee. In other words, he's saying, regardless to what you are going through, regardless to where you are, regardless to what you got to face, regardless to what has happened, regardless to what's happening, remember one thing, I am with you. So when it happens to you, it is also happening to me. I am with you. He goes on and he says, be not dismayed, For I am your God. Not that I am God. I am with you and I am your God. He says, hold on. Why? I will strengthen you. Yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with thy right hand. So I say to you this day, call upon the Lord and ask him to deliver you from whatever it is that got you down, from whatever it is got you feeling that you don't want to go on, whatever it is got you feeling that you are so lonely, that there is no one beside you, no one around you. I want you to know that you have the most important person in the world with you, and that is God. For he promised, I'll never leave you, and I'll never forsake you. Is there anything else that we need deliverance from? Yes, we do. We need deliverance from death doors situation. We need deliverance from death doors situation. There are some people today, all they can see ahead of them is death. There are some of us today, the devil may have death so close to us that if it were not for God, we would not live to see the end of the day. There are some of us today that the devil has it all planned how he is going to destroy us. For he had it all planned how he will destroy Daniel. In chapter 6, verse 14 to verse number 23, I want you to follow along with me carefully as I read these words for you from the book of Daniel. Then the king, when he had heard these words, was so displeased with himself, and set his heart on Daniel to deliver him. And he labored till the going down of the sun to deliver him. Then these men assembled unto the king and said unto the king, know, O king, that the law of the Medes and Persians is that no decree nor statute which the king established may be changed. In other words, king, remember, you have already made a decree. And I want you to know that the Lord does not allow you to get out of this decree that you have made. It cannot be changed. Then the king commanded, and they brought Daniel and cast him in the den of lions. Now, many times I have heard of people, and maybe I have said it before myself, made reference of how Daniel was cast in the lion's den. You see, to be cast in a lion's den is different to be cast into a den of lions. You could be cast in a lion's den and there are no lions there. But Daniel was cast into the den of lions. Now the king spake and said unto Daniel, thy God whom thou servest continually, he will deliver thee. Wow. This king, he wants Daniel to be delivered so bad, even though he's doing something that he did not want to do. But he went ahead and he signed the decree before he knew exactly who he was dealing with. And now he must follow through with the decree and throw Daniel in the den of lions. And he's telling Daniel that the Lord will deliver thee. And a stone was brought and laid upon the mouth of the den. And the king sealed it with his own signet, and with the signet of his lords, that the purpose might not be changed according to Daniel. Then the king went to his palace and passed the night fasting. Wow. He's in his house, his comfortable house. But regardless of what he wants to eat, he has no appetite to eat. Regardless of what he has to eat, there is no appetite to eat. The scripture goes on to say, neither were instruments of music brought before him, and his sleep went from him. So he's up all night. He's hungry, can't eat. He cannot enjoy the music, but he cannot sleep neither. So in verse number 19, the king arose very early in the morning and went in haste unto the den of lions. And when he came to the den, he cried with a lamentable voice unto Daniel. And the king spake and said unto Daniel, O Daniel, servant of the living God, is thy God whom thou servest continually able to deliver thee from the lions? And then all of a sudden, verse number 21 says, Then said Daniel unto the king, O king, live forever. My God had sent his angels and had shut the lion's mouth that they have not hurt me, for as much as before his innocence was found in me, and also before thee, O king, have I done no hurt. Then was the king exceeding glad for him, and commanded that they should take Daniel up out of the den. So Daniel was taken up out of the den, and no manner of hurt was found upon him, because he believed in God. No manner of hurt was found on him, because he believed in God. May I remind you, Daniel was brought before Babylon officials for his loyalty to God. He was brought before the Babylonian officials for his worship to God. Because of his worship to God, because of his stand for God, they threw him into the den of lions. Chapter 6, verse 17 and 18. Daniel spent a night with the lions in the den. I shared this with you many times before, and it bears sharing with you again. I went over to Africa, and while I was over there, we went in the wild one day, and they had all these lions and all these different animals that they wanted us to go and see. And they told us to come out of the vehicle, and we'll be able to get close to where they are so that we could take pictures. And when the vehicle pulled up, I saw one male lion stood up, and the mane on his back stood up in the air, and he began to roar. And as he began to roar, I could imagine my bones cracking in his mouth. And I said, me? Come outside? No way will I do that. Daniel did not lock himself up in a pickup like I did. Daniel was thrown in the den of lions. But Daniel was miraculously delivered by God from death, according to verse number 26 and verse number 27. Delivered by God from death, according to verse number 26 and verse number 27. Here is a promise to hold on to when you are faced with such things that it seems like you may die. And Psalms chapter 34, verse 7. The angel of the Lord encampeth round about them that fear him, and he delivered them. Regardless of what you are going through, regardless of what it looks like, I want you to know that the angels of the Lord are encamping round about you, and they would keep you safe. And then finally, what do we need deliverance from? We need deliverance from becoming bitter and resentful. You know, sometimes with all the things that are said about you, with all the things that are done to you, as a child of God, when you know that you're innocent of these things, and they're still said, and they're still done, sometimes God's children become very bitter, and we become very resentful. We need deliverance from becoming bitter and resentful. In the book of Acts, chapter 7, verse 54 to verse number 56, the Bible says, when they heard these things, they were cut to their heart, and they gnashed upon him with their teeth. What? when they heard the man of God, what he was saying based on the word of God hurt them so much, got them so angry, that they jumped on him and started to bite him up. But watch verse number 55, speaking of Stephen. But he, being full of the Holy Ghost, looked up steadfastly into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing on the right hand of God. Whoa! Isn't that beautiful that just before you would die, you would be able to look into heaven, and as looking into heaven, you see the Son of God. You see God standing up. You saw the glory of God and Jesus standing on the right hand of God. Isn't that a beautiful sight for you to see as you are getting ready to depart from this life? That's why I believe that when my secretary was getting ready to depart from this life, as she looked up into the heaven with the mask on her face and the breathing of oxygen and the pulling for breath, after I would have read for her, after I would have prayed for her, after we would have consoled her, and as she's slipping off into eternity, God gave her the strength, and she said, "Come, come, Pastor, come, 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 Pastor, come." Just look it up. And as I read this text, I thought, oh, she may have seen what this man of God saw. What he saw? He saw the glory of God while he was down on earth. He looked steadfastly into heaven. He saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. And watch this. Instead of he becoming bitter, instead of he becoming resentful, the Bible says, and said, "Behold, I see the heaven open and the Son of Man standing on the right hand of God." Wow. "And they cried out with a loud voice and stopped their ears and ran unto him with one accord." When he gave this testimony of what he saw, they got upset, even more upset, and they ran unto him, every one of them. And notice what they did. They cast him out of the city and stoned him. And the witnesses laid down their clothes at the young man's feet, whose name was Saul. Saul. Yeah. He was one of the witnesses. Boy, I believe that while he lived, these things may have plagued him. In verse number 59, "And they stoned Stephen, calling upon God and saying, 'Lord Jesus, receive my spirit.' And he kneeled down and he cried with a loud voice, 'Lord, lay not this sin to their charge.' And when he had said thus, he fell asleep." For many of us, seeing God in his glory, seeing Jesus standing at the right hand of the Father, for many would have said, "Lord, may they pay for what they have done." Some may have said, "May they rot in hell." Some may have said even worse than that. But watch this man of God who refused to be bitter, who refused to be resentful. His last words, he cared so much for his enemies. He said, "Lord, don't lay this to their charge." It takes a mature believer to be able to go through this type of treatment and refuse to be bitter. He took all the punishment they gave him, and he stood up for God with a testimony that was and is amazing. Who would not become bitter when trouble comes? When you did not go looking for trouble, all you did was just to be where God wanted you to be. And all you were doing is what God wanted you to do and where God wanted you to be. And then this, verse 56. "Behold, I see heavens open and the Son of Man standing on the right hand of the Father." As they stoned him, he glorified the Lord. Just be where God wants you to be. Just be doing what God wants you to do. And even if you would have to suffer for it, look at the beautiful benefits even before he left the earth. He was able to look in heaven and see the glory of God and saw Jesus Christ standing at the right hand, right where he was going, absent from this body, present with the Lord. So in closing, there is a promise for that according to God's word. In Psalms 50 and verse number 15, the Bible says, "And call upon me in the day of trouble, and I will deliver thee, and thou shalt glorify me." What troubles are you going through? Call on God when you are going through your troubles, and God will deliver you. Deliver you from what? He will deliver you from the fear or from the terror of fear. He will deliver you from depression and loneliness. He will deliver you from death doors situation. He will deliver you from becoming bitter and resentful. And whatever you are going through in life as a child of God, if you are in the will of God and you pray and ask God to deliver you according to his word, you will always get your answer. Here's what I must remind you. God's will should be prayed when we answer, when we pray. And when we pray, God's will be done. God's will always be done. So this man prayed and asked God to do all these things according to his word. And today, I'm asking you to ask the Lord to deliver you according to his word. Maybe I did not even touch on something that is bothering you, something that got you down. Or it may be some habit, some sin. I don't know what it is. It may be some problem. Whatever it is, find a verse of scripture that is speaking of God's will to that matter and ask God to deliver you according to his will. But here it is. For God to deliver you, you must be a child of God. So if you do not know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I invite you today to trust him before it is eternally too late. Now, you have heard this so many times. You may have said or saying, "I have heard that so often, and it's yet not too late." Well, let me be honest with you. It is one day closer too late. Why don't you trust him? He says, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." You need deliverance. You need rest from all of these things that are bothering you. I ask you to trust the Lord, and he will deliver you. If you are a child of God and you are like Elijah, you're depressed, you're lonely, you don't understand what's going on, things seems not to be working out in your favor, I ask you to call on the Lord and ask him to deliver you, and God will deliver you according to his word. Father, in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we give you thanks for everything that you have done. We love you, we praise you, and we thank you that you have delivered us. We thank you that you are delivering us, and we thank you that we can look in your word and see when and how you will deliver us, for it is done according to your word. Bless your people. Bless your word now. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let me say to all of you that took the time to sit and listen to the word today, I trust that you not only took the time to listen, but you have also taken the time to see if anything that was said in regards to the word of God that can apply to your life. And if anything that was said that you would need deliverance from, I trust that you would call out to him and ask him to deliver you. But most of all, commit yourself to him, because pretty soon now we are going to be with the Lord, and he will deliver us from every earthly thing that keeps us down. May God bless you. Thank you so much for listening.
Remember to share, like, comment, or subscribe, and we'll see you next week.